All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you guys this morning. Welcome to St. Clair Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us, welcome to everybody visiting us on social media this morning. We are thankful to be able to do that, and we consider you guys a part of us even if you can't be here, and we understand the not being here. So we'd just like to welcome you out and think about any announcement this week. Of course, we've got Labor Day tomorrow, so it's probably a holiday for most all of us, so enjoy your holiday. There's going to be no service tonight. We were supposed to meet at the park and have a picnic kind of thing, but we decided against that. And there's also no Wednesday night church this week. I think just because of the state things are in right now, we think it's best to not do Wednesday night church. Are there any other announcements that we need to talk about or think about? Excuse me. The yellow box, when was that supposed to be due?
We said next Sunday, since there was so many traveling this week. So I had sent out some sizes that Phil helped me get for Elissa and Uriel. So if anybody needs that back, just let me know and I'll send it again. But next Sunday, after the morning service, we'll have everything turned in.
Awesome, thank you. So next week, a yellow box, and if you don't know what that is, we just get everything yellow and fill this box full of yellow stuff. It's called a sunshine box, I guess, is another. We named it after sunshine back there. So we're doing that for Ulyssa and Uriel, who they recently moved back to Puerto Rico, so Ulyssa could be with her other children. So we hope they're doing well and hope that this box will bless them. Any other announcements to think about? Anything I've forgotten about? It's somewhere in the neighborhood of 110 days to Christmas. You need to know that. So, Mike jokes about that a lot, and Tim's not here to joke around about with. But, you know, it's kind of hard to believe it's September already, but here we are. All right, if no more announcements, what about birthdays or anniversaries? Anybody have a birthday this week? All right, Lisa had a birthday. Yesterday? All right, 29. Any other birthdays? Well, happy birthday, Lisa. Any anniversaries this week? All right. I guess there were no Labor Day weekenders for getting married or anything. So, if you're watching on social media and it was your birthday or anniversary, happy birthday or anniversary to you all. So right now, do we have any scripture readers this morning? All right, Alex, come on up.
Psalms chapter 119, verse 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path.
Alrighty. At this time, Villa, since next week is the walk for the care center, the walk for life, she's going to come up and give us a little information about that.
So Pastor Jim and Mike had asked me to pull a few statistics again, as we do every so often. So I'll just take a few minutes of your time, hopefully, but wanted to share some things that are prominent with the care center. It's been one of those things that I didn't even realize how many years it had been around. It's been around over 35 years here in our community. But it's one of those things that I was like, hey, I want to be part of that someday. And I didn't know how, but it was just something that obviously the Lord's divine grace brought together for me. But I want to make sure you all know, if there's ever a time that you want to be more involved, we're very open and receptive to volunteers, and even have board positions that come available from time to time if that's something that anyone is interested in. So a lot of folks are interested in the abortion statistics always, and that's something that's the main thing I want to hear when I hear a talk like this. You know, not only do we talk about preservation of life and the importance of, you know, the miracle that is life, we also have lots of services and things. So I'm going to talk to you about just a few of the statistics and then some of the things we're doing at the Care Center as we move into the Walk for Life this coming Saturday. So in 1973, obviously we know that the procedure of abortion was legalized. Approximately 62.5 million abortions have been performed since 1973. In Tennessee, the most recent official statistics from 2017 reflected that just in Tennessee, 12,140 abortions were performed in that year, in 1 year. One abortion occurs every 34 seconds in the United States. So while we're talking, almost two per minute abortions. Approximately 24,000 abortions are performed in the U.S. every day. Every year in America, almost a million abortions, 860,000. One in four pregnancies, that's 25%. One in four pregnancies, 25%. In the United States are terminated by abortion. And these are intentional, not in the medical field, we refer to miscarriages. It's the term, the official term is spontaneous abortion. That is not what we're talking about here. These are intentional abortions. Most women cite social reasons, not the mother's health, or rape or incest as their motivation in approximately 93% of all abortions. In 2018, 63% of young adults said they believed abortion should be legal in most states, while only 35% said it should be illegal in all or more states, leaving a low 2% undecided on the matter. And just a little bit about pregnancies and family, you know, planning and intent in the United States. In 2011, 45% of all pregnancies were reported as being unintentional by American women. So half of those were not expected or planned. Again, we do a lot of things besides just speaking to abortion-minded clients. One of the things at the Care Center over the last few years has been an attempt and a goal and initiative to try to increase our services, not just to women, but to men for family approach. So one of the things we started doing, we rebranded a few years ago and said, okay, it's no longer the Women's Care Center. A lot of us still refer to it as that so people will know what we're talking about when we say it, I know. But transitioning to the Care Center, because we do want to have an emphasis on the young men and fellows who are in the lives of these ladies that come in and again, look at it from a family perspective. So just a little bit about, because we're in Spring City, I wanted to give you a little bit of the statistics on what we do and what all we have going. In the year 2020, so that was last year, we had a total of 274 new clients in Dayton and Spring City. We broke that down. 256 of those were female and 18 of those were male. At the Spring City Satellite Office, We saw 81 new clients, so that's pretty impressive. We're only there in Spring City on New Lake Road on Mondays. Obviously, we won't be there tomorrow since it's a holiday, but if it's not a holiday, we're there on Mondays. Pending, there's no closures with COVID-related issues, of course. In Dayton, that's where we get to do the ultrasounds for 2020. We did 170. We do a lot of things, again, besides just the counseling. We also assisted 17 families with Christmas in 2020 with, you know, helping them provide for their families for Christmas. And this is one of the big things that I always like to say. It ranges and vacillates, obviously, from year to year. But in 2020, we saw 5 salvations. As a result of the work that the ladies and gentlemen at the care center do. And we do have male employees now too, so we're super excited about that. But 5 souls were saved. That might not have been otherwise. I'm sorry, that always overwhelms me. We also have a lot of impact in the lives of students in the counties. The EDGE program is an educational program that we are heavily involved in and drive. And somebody asked me this recently, and I couldn't name them just like that, so I wrote it down this morning. The EDGE students that we impact belong to the following areas: Ray County, Bledsoe County, Sequatchie County, Sail Creek, Rockwood, and Harriman. So that's how big of a reach, you know, the care center is beginning to have. I want to tell you just a second, in the year 2020, we gave away 643 diapers, and that doesn't sound extremely significant. But when I tell you we've increased our efforts, and on August the 4th this year, just a month ago, we gave away over 1,800 items, including 1,500 diapers. There was formula, baby food, and baby wipes. So we're also providing for families that, you know, have significant need. The Walk for Life is coming up on this coming Saturday, September 11th. Very important. Patriot Day. I do, I love and I'm honored to represent us. If anyone else ever wants to be involved, please, please, please always know that that is completely wide open. But if you have questions, doubts, concerns, you know, interest in providing or assisting in some way, always just let us know, because as we know, you know, we all can't be gung-ho and do everything, but every one of us can contribute probably a little something in the effort that our church has a heart and desire for in representing and supporting the care center. So I thank you all. If you have questions, let me know. I do have a few copies of some of the statistics on abortion if you would like to have a copy of that as well. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Bill, for that. And, you know, it, hearing those statistics, they're, you know, kind of, it hit you in a, it hit me in a hard way sitting there until got to the part where there were 5 salvations. That was awesome to hear. And it makes me really proud to know that our church is behind that, because, and is supportive of the care center, because what people in those positions need, what families need, what those women in those positions need is a place of love where they can land. Because if they don't have a place of love, they have a place of the world that they're going to land, and it's just going to help them and reassure them that what they're going and what they're seeking and going at it is okay. But thankfully, there's a place in our community that is bringing God's love and God's grace to the forefront in those situations, because that's what those people need. They need to experience Jesus and His love there. So right now, let's go through our prayer list. And And this is long, so just bear with me as I read it. And if I mispronounce anything, I'll give you permission to yell at me the right pronunciation. So Buddy Caraway, James Doble, Tina Peake, Margaret Cunningham, Sue Smith is a praise, Nancy Cranfield, Cindy Smith, Connor Roy, the parents of Beth Fisher and Melissa Goins, Lou Henry, Dylan, who's Mickey's grandson, Cody Isham, Kurt's friend's mother, Ray Harrison with surgery coming up. I guess that's this Tuesday, correct? So this Tuesday, Kelsey Goins, Tom Osborne, Don Brown's sister Bernice, Mickey, Oric, and his co-workers, and that was because they were out in the heat and in the weather, and thankfully the Lord's turned the thermostat down just a little bit, but I'd say it's still hot out there on the asphalt, so keep remembering them. Boyd Cunningham, the family of Betty Payne, Charbo and Tonda Thompson, Sue Newby, Lydia, and that's Sue and Harold's great-great-granddaughter, Mary Hill, Donnie Hinch, who lost a brother and a sister, Billy Thedford's grandsons and dad, Kurt Smith, Brother Harold's Uncle Tommy, Luke Cobb, Thelma Wood is a praise and still asking prayers there, Earlene Houston's daughter Anna, Jim Rowland, Tyler Raines, and he started a new job last week. I hope that's going well. Scarlett Kilgore, Nolan Cantrell, service electric workers who were responding to the storm, Anna Armstrong Hospital, Marlene Didlake, the family of Mike Howard, Afghanistan Concerns, and Beverly Duckett, Michael Tenton, COVID Victims and Healthcare, Stanley Cunningham, Jerry and Donna Cox, Donnie Hill's grandson, our veterans, David Edwards, Red Garrett, Harold Fisher, Ronnie Masterson, Freddie Locke, Sharon, Mary's grandmother, Melissa Goins' uncle, Gerald Collin, Kurt's brother and family, Doug Houston, Burton Barrett, Leonard and Steve Newby, Sean Reese, Eddie Butler, Max Douglas, Johnny Reed, Hannah Wright, Howard Clark, Dalton Marshall and CJ Cox, Tremaine Chapman, Billy Ray Gideon, Mike and Deborah Payne, Terry Henry, Mary Knipe's grandpa, The Lost, our schools and students, Dean and Lisa Loden, Harold Goins, The Unspokens, the victims of Hurricane Ida, Tim Holloway, Lena Silva, the family of Sharon Bilbrey, Harry Williams, Artero, who's a friend of Brother Harold, and then this morning we had Junior Fugit added, and the Jason Owens family. Is there anything else we'd like to add or any updates on any of those?
Scarlett Kilgore's in there.
All right. All righty. Scarlett Kilgore and Tim Holloway. I don't know how Mike does this every week. I forget where they're at in the list. Maybe he's got it memorized a little better than I do. I think Jim's taking notes too, so maybe he'll get me there. Anything else?
Nick put a bell on her because she's done something with me.
Uh-oh. Remind me, what's Brady's last name?
Kill.
Okay. Thank you. I knew it was something started with a K, but I wanted to say something else. And as we think about Afghanistan and the concerns there, of course, we talked about them last week, but, you know, keep praying. The things that have been in the news is this week is that, you know, in places in Afghanistan, away from where the media is at, especially in Kabul, that things have been really bad. And now that, you know, the final and last American soldiers have been out, things are ramping up in Kabul also. So just keep remembering that and the church there.
Here's the football player in America, 2 miles,
and that's a big one. I don't really realize all the time until I'm talking to somebody, but I played football from the time I was 5 till I was 18 through my freshman year in college. And the worst thing that I ever did was I dislocated my left ring finger. But, you know, that's I'm very much the exception in there. That's one of those things that people get hurt a lot in. So, yeah, remembering them and their safety. Well, if there's nothing else, Kurt, would you open us in prayer this morning?
Gracious God, and Heavenly Father, thank you again for this day, Lord. Father, we thank you so much for sacrificing your Son, our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross for our sins. Father, we ask that you answer all our prayers that we lift up to you, Father. We know you well, whether it be physical or spiritual. We thank you so much for the answered prayers that we do have. And Father, we ask that you give Pastor Jim the words to speak and have us have our hearts open, our ears open to use these words, use the message we get today, and we can share the gospel with the lost, with the ones that are in living in darkness, that we may be the light that shines in the darkness for them. Should boldly share the gospel with the lost and with no reservations at all. Father, we ask that you bless this service again. We just ask everything in the majesty of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and all God's children say.
Amen. All right, brother Phil.
Number 510 in the blue book, Heaven Came Down.
Thank you.
5:16.
Thank you.
At this time, do we have any special music? I don't think we've got quite enough youth here to get a youth bunch together. So, anybody have a song this morning before we get Brother Jim up here? All right, Brother Jim.
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate you for filling in for Mike today and being there. And we're glad to see each one of you today that are here as we come to worship together, as we come to be in God's house. What a special time when God's family is all together. And it's He blesses us with His presence always, but it blesses us when we're here to be a part of that presence. Villa, thank you this morning for the comments and the thoughts. I was thinking as you were talking, well over 60 million babies have been aborting since the United States has gotten into this. I was listening this morning, and as you may have heard, Texas passed a new law that was upheld because the Supreme Court wouldn't look at it, which limits abortion after 6 weeks. And it was interesting that Portland, Oregon, which I think we could probably call today the capital of evil in the United States, said they were going to boycott the Texas because they had passed this. Can you imagine in our nation, a nation that has uplifted itself for holding out, for taking care of people and for considering people, going to boycott because they can't murder people? It's a sad day in our nation. And one of the things I think that we have seen take place is that we have gotten to the point where we as individuals kind of accept the fact of what's going on. We accept the fact, and we probably don't pray as hard, we don't take our stands. I think we need to remind ourselves again, abortion's murder. Are we going to move to the point that we legalize murder as some of our cities are doing today because they just turn their back on it, don't pay any attention to it? We can never get to the point that we turn our back on what God has told us, what's a basic part of what we have in our Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill. This morning, I want us to think for a few moments, reaching for God's goal. Paul's writing to the church at Philippi. The scripture that we'll look at in a few moments is Philippians 3, 12 through 14. Paul, as he writes to the church at Philippi, reminds them what has challenged him to do his mission work and encourages them to look to the goals that are before them, the goals that Jesus set for them. Sometimes we need to remind ourselves and look again to the goals that Jesus put before us. Do we look at our life's goals and we remind ourselves they're built around what Jesus taught us to do? How critical do we consider our walk for Him in all that we do? Paul thought it was very critical in what he did. He was trying to always keep before him Jesus as his example. He says, this is what I want to do. This is what my effort's about. This is what he writes to the church of the Philippians to remind them. Realize these goals that are there. Realize what's taking place. When I was in seminary, there was a young man that was there. His name was Jesse. Everything seemed to be against him. He had cerebral palsy. It was difficult for him to negotiate and get up and down the halls, especially the steps. It was difficult for him to make himself understood at times, and extremely difficult for him to write. And so I would watch him as We would take tests. When we'd finish up, the rest of us would be through. We'd pass hours in. We'd leave, and he would sit there sometimes for another hour to 2 hours to just do a test that was being given him. Everything about it seemed to say, you just need to not really try. But you know what he looked at? He wanted to be everything that God intended for him to be. No matter the challenge, no matter what was before him, he was going to give his all for that. I remember when we went back after one summer, he'd gotten married. He had a beautiful wife. And I remember that that day somebody was asking him, said, well, Jesse, how is marriage? And he said, it's so good, I wish I had been born that way. Any of y'all ever felt that way? They turned this way. That David does. See, a Villa Point in David feels it. She told him he felt that way. They turned to his wife and said, well, how do you feel? And she said, I'm not quite to that point yet within him. But he was excited. Some years later, I was back in New Orleans in one of the family rescue centers. There was Jesse. He had ended up. He had become what God intended for him to be. He took care of families in New Orleans. He reached out to them. He took care of children all around him. What he had done, he had learned as Paul did. He walked in God's will. Whoever we are, whatever our difficulties, if we walk in God's will, he'll pick us up. He'll make us different in all that we do. Let's look at that third chapter of Philippians 12 through 14. Paul writing, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after it. If that I may apprehend, that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What Paul is saying, that's my goal. That's what I want to do, is press towards that mark. What he's saying to us is, will you make every effort in life because you have been taken hold of by Jesus? Apprehended is a word we use today when we're reaching out for somebody that we usually the laws after they've been apprehended, they've been taken hold of. Paul is saying, I have been taken hold of by Jesus Christ. I'm in his hand. He has my life. Do you realize the importance of that? Do you realize what it's saying? You can put it together through some of the other things that Jesus said. He reminded us that once you're in my hand, nobody can take you out. Once I have taken hold of you, I'm going to hold on to you. You're in my grasp, and I'm going to make sure that I've got you. Have you ever watched daddies when children are small, and they'll come and they'll say, come on, jump to daddy. And that little one in total faith will leap out across and trusting totally that daddy's going to catch him. He's going to pick him up. And daddy is. He'll give everything he can do about it. There's no doubt in that child's mind. There should be no doubt in our mind that when God takes hold of us, he's going to keep hold of us. He's going to hold us, and he's going to help us become what we're willing to do. Ann Hawks was the writer of the hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour. very early in life, she found she had a real talent for writing verse. And she loved to write it. A little later, as she was in church, her pastor encouraged her to use that talent fully in what she was doing. He encouraged her to write. He was a hymn writer, encouraged her to write it because these work real well in hymns. One morning, as Ann was up, she already had a family. She was just thinking. And all of a sudden, she felt the presence of God nearer than she had ever felt before. And she began to wonder how anybody could live without that presence of God in their lives. Whether it was good times or bad times, that He reached out to you. He would take care of you. And so she sat down and she began to write. And she wrote the words, "I need Thee every hour, most gracious Lord." A very beautiful hymn. It didn't take it long to catch on. And the people loved it, and they wanted to hear it. And then Ira Sankey and Dwight Moody and some of their revivals picked it up, especially across England and that area. They sang it over and over. And the people then just fell in love with it. And they would say that in their deepest hours of need, whether it was in loss of someone, whether it was in problems within their life, that song just lifted them up. Well, Anne was excited that the people liked it, but she wasn't sure what the real secret was to it until some years later, Anne lost her husband. And she said she remembered that song, and she went back to it, and she began to sing it, and said all of a sudden, it touched her life in such a powerful way. She understood why people had loved it across the years, because she realized that in her greatest need, God had taken hold of her and lifted her up. That's what Paul is saying. God wants to lift you up. He wants to hold you. He wants to take care of you and all the things that are going on. When I was a young minister, had a lady that she kind of adopted me and looked after me, which I certainly needed a lot of looking after in those days, in those early days, because it was easy for me to mess up. I knew by the way she lived, she loved the Lord, and she wanted to follow His will. She was a born leader, though she never wanted to be out front. One time, they went through a period of time at the church, and they didn't have a music leader, and she was gifted in music, but she wouldn't stand up in front of a choir. They put a red light up in the top of the church, and they had a pedal on it that she could pat her foot, and she patted the time for the choir to see. And nobody ever knew who was leading the choir. But she took care of them. She led them when they practiced, but not when she was out in front of people. She never wanted to be someone that looked like that God was putting out front. She wanted to be in the background in all she did. But she challenged me over and over in many things. And one day she told me, she said, "God has blessed you with talent. Don't be afraid to use it. Use it to reach people. Use it to make a difference." And she did her best to she got me in more trouble doing stuff. But she helped me see that, hey, you can do things. You can make a difference because God has you in the hand. He has you in His grip. If you'll allow Him, He'll make you into what you want. He wants you to be. Second thing Paul is asking us, have you ever seen what your God can do? Ever thought about that? Have you ever seen what your God can do? If so, why do you worry? Why do you have problems with that? Paul, in the third chapter of Philippians, 10th verse, he says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. He's saying that I may know him, that I may fully understand what God is doing in my life. We as Christians believe we're in God's hand. So why do we worry about every little thing? Why do we not accept the fact that he will take us and make us into what he wants to be? Thomas Edison was one of the great inventors of all time. Every day he got up thinking and striving about what he would do the next day. What would be the next great thing? One day as he was sitting and writing, he wrote this thought down. If we did all the things we were capable of doing, we would astound ourselves. If we did all that we're capable of doing, we would astound ourselves. Have you ever thought about what God sees in you? What he's gifted you with? And if you allow him to use it, what a difference it will make in the world. You were put here for a purpose. You were put here to make a difference. Do we allow him to do it? Or do we, like so many times and so many people, limit ourselves by doubting what God will do through us? Doubting that we have that ability to make a difference. You know, there's a tendency in our world today, especially among Christians today, to kind of push this aside, that our Christianity is not the primary thing in our lives. It should be the primary thing, because without it, what difference does life make? Without Jesus, what difference does life make? What do you do? What do you accomplish? What's going to happen? It's been said that so many people turn away in disappointment because they do not see in Christians anything that's different from the world about them. It's a reminder of what we're here for, what we were placed here for. Do you realize you as a believer owe to the world about you what someone did in your life? Somebody told you about Jesus. Somebody shared with you about Jesus one day. And because of that, you have an obligation to share that with others, to make a difference in what we do. One writer has said that our Christian life sometimes begins like a flowing river. It's flowing, it's crystal clear, it's going when we first start out. But we have a tendency to become stagnant in what we do. We slow down. We get over the excitement of being a Christian. As I looked at that, I thought about the River Jordan. When you're over there and you're looking at it, it takes such a prominent role in the writings of the men across the ages in the scripture about the River Jordan. You go into the Jordan Valley and it's all built around it. Well, as you look at that river, it's flowing. It's relatively clear. It comes off of tops of the mountains where it begins. It's out of the crystal waters, clear water of snow as it flows down. And as you look at coming through the Jordan Valley, along the way, everything around it grows. In an area that without water, nothing grows. But you see the fields and all the things there. Beautiful areas as it flows through. But as it keeps going, something happens to the River Jordan. It flows into the lowest spot on earth that we know of. It flows into the area called the Dead Sea. And all of a sudden, this very living river becomes dead. Nothing lives around it. Nothing lives within it. It becomes totally stagnant. It has no purpose anymore, our offering to the world. We are warned not to become like that. We're warned to look at what God wants us to do. Don't get in our faith to the point we're so content that we're just satisfied to sit down, to come to worship, but do nothing about changing the world around us. It's our obligation to change our world. I was reminded of that this week as the 29th of August came along and we had another hurricane fixing to hit. I was reminded of Katrina and what happened within our state. But I was reminded of something else as I thought back about it that didn't dawn on me at the time. I never realized that through the years that I worked in disaster relief and worked some 40 years, that God, through that, was preparing me for what was to come. He was getting me ready to face what we faced in Katrina. I learned about how to handle funds and how the money that we designated coming in for disaster relief, how we put it, we took care of it, to make sure that that fund was always there if something bad happened. And so when Katrina came, we didn't have to worry about how we started out. We had the funds there ready for it. Made sure along the way that I knew the other guys that were involved in disaster relief in the other states. A lot of them were very dear friends, partners in what we did. In the morning after Katrina, I could pick up the phone, call three of my best friends in the Carolinas and in Georgia and saying, hey guys, we need a partner. You know what they said? We'll be there. What a difference it made. What a difference it made. Across the years, some that were involved in different areas of law enforcement said, we need a law enforcement group, and we developed one. Another group said, we need a medical group, and we developed one. We had builders. We had people that knew how to do distribution. We had a strong communication unit that had developed. Each one of those things reached out to make a difference. The communication group took over the police communications in Biloxi for a time so that they could help them. The others did all the things. In the process, we had the largest Baptist Walmart operation ever was at Biloxi. Tons of supplies given away. People pulling through to make a difference. God prepared him. He made it happen. He was saying, let me show you something, what can be, what will happen. Do we in our lives live in such a way that we realize God uses us and prepares us for what's to come? He's preparing you for something today. Are we ready to do it? More or less, are we willing to do what he asks us to do? Paul kind of concludes in it as he writes to the church there. And we're, as you see this, you'll see we're backing up in Scripture. But over in Philippians, the second chapter, he's saying, let's win with Jesus. Let's win. We've got the winning combination. 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal to God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon them the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. He's saying, take on the mind of God. Do you want to win? Be like him. Be like Jesus. I was in communication yesterday with Villa while Colton's team was playing. They had a close ball game, 58-14 they won. And I guarantee you, they were trying to be the best they could be. They were trying to be what a coach had taught them to be. That's what Paul is saying for us. He's saying, let me coach you. Let me tell you what's important. He said, Jesus became obedient. He was willing to die for us. Let us be obedient to him. Let us follow the greatest coach that ever lived in what he did. As we do this, we'll be encouraged. We'll be shown how to face the evil that is put before us. How to defeat that evil. In faith, we can be greater than anything the world can send our way. We can win. We can be winners in all that we do and what we're doing. Paul loved athletics. You see it in his writings. He talks about running the race and all the different things about winning the prize. What he was illustrating for us is that we're running in the greatest race of our life. It's the race for Jesus to change the world about us. As I was looking and studying this week, I saw this statement that came forth saying, this is what Christianity is all about. I am not what I ought to be. I am not yet what I hope to be. I am not what I once was. By the grace of God, I am what I am and will become what he wants me to be. Think about that. I will become what he wants me to be. That should be our goal in life. If we yield to him, we can walk in the power and grace that he's given us. We're reminded it was all in the resurrection. He taught us that the moral law of God, what God gave us, guides us. And forget the false law of the world. We can overcome that. Because Jesus is alive, we're reminded in the scripture this very thing. He is constantly before God. He's standing in for you. When you mess up, he says to God, God, he's messed up again. But God, he's mine. He's in my hand. Take care of him. Let's show him what he can be. He's saying to God, these are my children. I redeemed them. I've given them new life. God, let's make them into what they can be. With Jesus, we can always be winners. Our goal should be like him and to one day be with him through all eternity. That's what Paul was writing to the church of the Philippians. He was saying, guys, this is what you've been given. This is what Jesus did for you. Now, folks, what are you going to do for him? That would be Paul's question to us today. What difference are you going to make for Jesus? Let's pray. Father, you loved us so much. You sent Jesus, your only Son, to die for us, to redeem us, to make us new, to give us that new life. And Father, in that new life, we have a commitment. We have a commitment to give it away. We can't keep it. We're to touch others. For Father, your plan was not to lose anyone. And you placed it in our hands to make a difference. Help us, Father, to be able to live the way you've called us to. May we this week, as we walk, may we see the faces of the lost around us. And may they touch us in such a way that immediately we want to tell them about the love of Jesus Christ. what difference it makes in their lives. I pray that if there's anyone here this morning that has never accepted Jesus as their Savior, they'd open their hearts, invite Him into their lives. Father, what a difference we can make in our world as we live for Him. Bless us during our time of invitation, for we pray these things now in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together.
Name.